percentage, it will be a fixed rate, that is so many rupees, irrespective of change in the international prices.
Right.
The duty remains the same, which is a practice in countries like the US. But some of the successive government felt that it is an avenue to collect the revenue.
So you don't agree? Is it just a minute?
As an economist, I think there is a need to debate on that, because all the, I mean, the successive governments have been not adopted the Tax Reforms Committee's recommendation. Okay. In fact, it is headed by Kelker.
Okay, and at least you're accepting, at least you're accepting to some extent that you're not in agreement with what's happening.
Only this, for with, the first with, time, Dharmendra Pradhan has openly admitted that this is for Sachin, and this is not the official stand of the government, because somehow they have been enjoying this increasing revenue, whether it was during the UPA government or no.
Okay, but let me just go across. I'll just come to you in a second. Let me just go across to Abhishek Singhvi. So Abhishek Singhvi, even Jagdish Shettigar, though representing the BJP.
No, I'm not.
You're just speaking independently.
As an economist.
As an economist is not entirely convinced. Are you, Abhishek Singhvi, convinced by the government's rhetoric that this is important to fund various government schemes?
Srinivasan, let me first of all compliment you for illustrating so graphically and tellingly something which we knew and know, but the effect of which is not always understood. But your graphics illustrate it very, very tellingly. And also let me compliment Dr. Shettigar, who has spoken with a certain degree of candor, because as professionals, as an economist, you can't really just go along with the political leaning, because the facts are otherwise. Quite frankly, this could be called highway robbery by an ordinary citizen. Now, I understand all governments, including ours, has a large tax arbitrage.
Yes.
We've had that. That's not the point. But look at a cascading effect, what you're doing now. The degree, you know, as somebody said, that differences of degree make for differences of kind. First and foremost, you have a base 26 rupees per liter oil barrel price.
Yes.
Let's assume it to be 30 and the Indian level. 4 rupees is not going to matter. You land up with a huge, huge arbitrage of virtually 21 rupees and 27% tax.
Hmm. Hmm.
Secondly, as has already been pointed out, it is hugely harassing, and it is in fact killing, because it hits and cripples the poor. Ultimately, we all crib, but we all get along with it because we can afford it.
No, but would you have said,
thirdly, with this kind of oil prices, which are now down to $60, with prices down at 6.5, this GDP, which has been redefined by Mr. Modi's government, should be galloping at 9%.
Yeah.
And most importantly, and we've been shouting in Parliament, our GST model did not have these heavyweight exclusions. It did not have petrol, alcohol, and there's another item. All these three, four items excluded. Now you have this one nation, one tax, hoo-ha.
One second.
Hullabaloo. What is this one nation, one tax?
Okay,
when you have
I think
21 rupee tax excise and a 27% VAT.
Okay, one second. Jagdish Shettigar,
it's a bit too much.
Okay, Jagdish Shettigar disagrees with you on the your point about the fact that your GST was not exclusionary. Go ahead.
Even 2011. Bill also, that is Amendment Act also, that also kept petroleum products outside the GST regime.
Right.
This may be a compromise made because the state government wanted to keep liquor and tobacco outside, because that is a revenue earning model. Probably in that context, the center retained this retail. So
okay,
I think the best thing that they should keep, I mean, bring GST into the petroleum products into the GST.
Yeah, so that 28% is a peak rate.
Today,
You can't then go on sort of tinkering with it.
Probably in today's context, price would have been around
35 rupees, 2014 onwards.
Abhijit Sen, I want to ask you, former member Planning Commission, as an economist, where do you weigh in on this? Do you believe that there is some merit to the manner in which these taxes have been raised, or do you think it's now simply out of control?
Look here, I mean, the facts are the following. Last year, our import bill on crude was $70 billion. At the prices of 2014, there would have been $160 billion. Okay? So the government saved, this country saved $90 billion.
Right.
Where did this $90 billion go? It didn't go to the consumer, because the consumer prices are roughly the same.
Right.
They were about 70 rupees then for petrol, they're about 70 rupees now.
Right.
Might have fallen slightly, but not much. It didn't go to the state governments.
Right.
Because state governments didn't get much of the increased revenue. It's all collected by the central government.
Right.
Now, what we are talking about is the central government's collections, and this is what surprises me often in the tax collection side.
Yes.
That if these are the numbers, that the country itself gained about $90 billion.
Yes.
We are talking about numbers which are between 30% to 40%.
Yes.
Of central government revenue and expenditure.
Yes.
So a lot of what you're seeing in terms of expenditure growth over the last 3 years and things is totally attributable to the oil price drop.
Okay.
As a country, we gained. As a government, the government gained. And the question really should be, has that gain been properly passed on? I personally think,
yes,
that the best way of passing on the gain is not necessarily reduce prices of petroleum products.
Okay.
It is spend that money on things which are worth it. The
but
country must ask whether or not...
Where has it been spent?
But where is that money
whether
been
or
spent?
Not what they have got with this huge amount.
Well, this is the question. This
yes.
is the question that, I mean, again, it's very hard to actually sit and now measure and calibrate and calculate how that amount of money has been spent. But when you see, just, you know, as you experience as a citizen, especially as an urban citizen, the kind of urban collapse that you see in city after city, right? When you see the kind of, we saw what happened to Bombay. We've seen that happen to Chennai. We've seen that happen to Bangalore. We've seen that happen to Delhi. I mean, just at a very anecdotal level, I'm not trying to overly analyze here, you begin to wonder, where has all this money gone?
Absolutely. Srinivasan, now they are saying that they are spending it on railways, on roads, etc. And I don't know when it will show up in terms of actual infrastructure.
Right.
But again, taking off from where Abhijit Sen left, they could have done a balance. You could still have collected enough to drive infrastructure.
Yeah.
And given the consumer at least a 10-15% relief in the last 2 months itself, the price have gone up by 15%.
So let me put that to Abhishek. Abhishek, you know, it's easy, some say, to criticize when you're in opposition, but were you to have been in power and were you to have inherited this windfall of this huge drop in crude prices, are you saying that you would not have hiked taxes to this extent? And you would have then been prepared to have to go, you know, to
I will
deal
tell
with the
you
consequences
what we would have done.
Have
I would
less,
have
less cash in the kitty.
I would tell you what any sensible government would have and should have done, and in all probability we would have done that. I can only speculate because we are not in power. 90 billion is a very interesting and a very vital figure just mentioned. I was not aware of that figure, but I knew it was a humongous figure. I knew that. Now, you can do three things or two things with it. One, you can pass on at least a 20% arbitrage of that to the consumer. What is the harm?
Right.
If you make 20% reduction, somebody mentioned 15%, I think 20% is a minimum. You have no evidence of that?
Mm.
Second, although it comes in the black hole known as the Consolidated Fund of India, you can voluntarily call it a tied revenue stream or a kind of a cess.
Right.
That look, this is a windfall we are having. We won't commingle it with the general consolidated fund, but we'll keep a large chunk of it, call it the infrastructure fund, call it the road fund, call it the rail, whatever you like.
Yeah.
But the moment you earmark it, then accountability increases.
Right.
What is happening is the black hole of the Consolidated Fund of India It's very nice to say we are building roads, sanitation, villages, this, that, and the other. There is no accountability
also,
to the tied kind of a object of that revenue stream.
I take your third point.
Is very important. In all likelihood, it has gone to sustain these expenditures.
Okay.
Administrative expenditures, which is the worst kind of non-development expenditure.
No, because
the government bureaucracy and all these, you know, file pushing travel.
No, so I think this is something Dr. Shetty got.
Let me bring in
Jagdish Shettigar, because this is again the confusing thing, isn't it? As I think Venu mentioned, or I think Abhijit Sen mentioned, that when you have this huge pot of cash, you'd certainly expect the economy to be doing better. But instead, we're actually seeing a slowdown. It's a huge paradox, isn't it? Because in some ways, it's actually the dream economic scenario for any government.
I'm saying it's 9% actually.
Oil prices
9%
fall
at this rate.
You know, inflation gets under control. Your fiscal bookkeeping is under control, and yet we are seeing a slowdown.
No, that is there are many reasons. Internally, of course, the domestic investors have got wait and watch approach because some of the demand has not been coming forward. In fact, if you look at the consumer price index, which is below 2%, which is not a good. I mean, politically you can claim credit for that, we have brought down the price, but from the point of view of the growth, it indicates that there is a slowdown actually. It matches with your industrial production index actually.
Okay.
So that is not. And another thing, internationally, because we have been depending on though we are not an export-led growth, but still about 15-16% depends on the external market.
Wherever major
markets are not doing well, whether it is the US or the Eurozone
Venu, I want to come to you with another point, which often again doesn't get talked about when we ask where the money is going. Is the amount of unused funds. It's one thing to go on saying, I'm going to keep taxing you and I'm going to keep adding to the kitty. But if you look at the number for unused funds, our research found that a CAG report analyzed by the Hindu 2014-15 found 1.4 lakh crores of funds are currently lying unused with the government. This is everything from, you know, secondary and higher education cess, 64,000 crores unused. Transfer of funds from excise duty on motors, 1,219 crores unused. Utilization of Nirbhaya fund, another 1,000 crores unused. I mean, it just goes on and on.
This is bad expenditure management.
Yeah.
But Srinivas, a larger point, as Abhijit said, if they have $80-90 billion, assuming that the poor middle class is paying such high taxes on petrol, for the government to boost public investment, which Mr. Jaitley has been saying last 2-3 budgets, the least I would expect is that in these public investments, at least the employment in the organized sector would go up, but employment growth has plummeted by 80% in the organized sector, you know. How do you explain that?
We have very little time. Let me just go to each panelist and ask them just a very simple question, starting with you, Dr. Abhijit Sen. You said that it's not necessary for the government to actually reduce taxes, but to pass it on
to the consumer.
But ensure that the money is spent wisely. If you would have a single line of advice to the government, given the kind of economic scenario you're seeing right now, what would that be?
Spend money properly. I mean, the point is that this government
specifically
is the luckiest government. I was in government for 10 years. We didn't see anything like this. It's a lucky government and it's bad spending.
Okay. That's put crisply and bluntly. Abhishek Singhvi, were you to have been in government today in this scenario, would you recommend now rolling back some of these taxes, rolling back some of the excise hikes?
I don't think humility or acceptance of partial fallibility is the hallmark of this government.
No, I'm saying if it were left to you,
I don't expect rollbacks. Even today, straight away they can do this. Give a cushion of 20% and create tied funds. Name it. That out of the 90 billion, X percent shall go only for roads, Y for railways, and Z for something else.
Okay.
Because the moment you created a cess-like, fee-like fund, accountability humongously increases. Then you can monitor it. In the Consolidated Fund of India, you can't monitor it. You only have the government's general, what you heard Mr. Pradhan say, oh, we are building roads and water and telephone and this right. and that. There's no accountability. There's no tied, audit.
Okay. Jagdish Shettigar.
You have to create that structure.
What would you say? Rollback exercise?
I don't suggest rollback and all.
Okay.
I'll simply say that bring petroleum products and tobacco and alcohol within the GST net. And the price would be around 35 rupees a liter.
So you're saying just take the GST route.
Yeah.
The states are going to fight tooth and as they have been. States are going to fight tooth and nail to oppose it.
So you treat these products also on par with the rest of the product. That is what is the original objective of the GST. That is a one tax and one market. That is the philosophy of the GST. And that should be treated.
Do you see that as likely or not politically?
You know, they will have to do it because they have promised to bring petroleum into GST in due course, and they have promised to refine the rates also and reduce it 28% to 18%.
Till such time, but is there a way out of this?
Yeah, I think they should drop prices by at least 15 to 20%, drop taxes by 15-20%, therefore prices, and they will still have enough money to drive their infrastructure. And bad spending that they're doing, it won't get affected either way. You know?
Okay, well, you know, given the fact that there is now growing public unrest over this, I think there may be some hard thinking that the government will have to do on this politically. Well, thank you so much for joining us on what's been a fascinating debate. That's it on Reality Check. Thanks for watching. Good night.